Who, me?
No, Kathy.
Oh, sorry.
Kathy, can you hear me? Or not?
No puedo.
No puedo.
So, it says something like internal meeting.
What's a meeting ID?
The meeting ID is, hold on. It's 865-4409-7946. The thing is that the webinar isn't live yet. That's the problem. That's why people aren't allowed, like aren't able to get in, but I can, let me send you, that's the meeting ID there.
Normally we'll say they haven't started, right?
Just like single.
Bruno. Bruno want to be in the webinar. As you can see.
So are we all ready to start in a minute?
As ready as I'm going to be.
All right. Let me just...
Yeah. About what?
This internal meeting.
Pedro keeps saying that he cannot hook into the
Webinar.
Can you send me an email with the invitation again, Laura? I'm sorry to bother you with this.
Yeah, I can. It's not an internal meeting, so I don't know.
Why they get that message?
I'll resend the invitation, but.
Probably. Yeah, bang. You don't want that. Forward.
Give me a second because I'm trying to like do eight things at the same time.
Pedro, try this one.
How are you sending it out?
Sorry?
Okay.
Okay, Pedrito, I'm going to send it again, okay?
I send this.
She sent it to me.
Already. I send the one you sent me, don't worry.
Okay.
By email instead of the one by WhatsApp.
Okay, I'm gonna, so we're live now, okay? Just FYI, everyone. Let's give people a minute. Is someone screen sharing?
Okay.
I love that photo, Clara.
I love that photo too.
I have that toy in my life.
Oh, you have it?
Yeah. I have it.
So we're just going to give everyone a couple more minutes and then we'll start. Is everyone ready?
Ready.
Yes. Yes, I'm ready here.
All right. All right, I think we can get started and people will slowly kind of join us as we go, but we'll keep to the 6:03 p.m. start time. So for those that are joining us, welcome to the webinar, The Space in Between, Bakehouse Photographers in Dialogue, presented by the Bakehouse Art Complex. Thank you for joining us. My name is Laura Novoa, and I'm the Curatorial and Public Programs Associate at the Bakehouse Art Complex. The Bakehouse is a nonprofit organization founded in 1985 by artists for artists in a formal industrial Art Deco era bakery. It provides studio residencies, infrastructure, and community to over 60 local artists. Our mission is to address the need for affordable live work, and workspaces for artists in Miami's urban core. For the ongoing and critical support we receive, the Bakehouse would like to thank its private and public sponsors, including the Knight Foundation, the Paris Family Foundation through Crearte, and the Miami Foundation, Miami-Dade County, and the Department of Cultural Affairs, and the State of Florida and its Division of Cultural Affairs. I would also like to thank the Wiley Family Foundation and Ackerman LLP. I am also very grateful to the four Bakehouse artists who are participating in today's webinar: Rose Marie Cromwell, Diana Espin, Mateo Serna Zapata, and Clara Toro. I will start the webinar by briefly speaking about the exhibition, The Space in Between, at the Bakehouse, which features the four artists who are with us today. And then each of the artists will introduce themselves and speak a little bit about their practice before we continue on to a conversation. So please feel free to ask any questions or share any comments in the chat box to the right-hand side of the screen during the webinar. Once again, thank you for joining us tonight. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook for information on future virtual programming and Bakehouse artist updates. So let me get my not very techie self situated. I'm gonna share the screen. And actually get me back to the first slide. So here's the exhibition. Let me hide the sidebar. So this is the Bakehouse atrium. It doesn't really do the exhibition or the artists in the exhibition justice, but here it is. Just to give a little bit of background, The Space in Between was on view at Bakehouse before we closed due to the pandemic. And before The Space in Between, the Amsterdam-based nonprofit, the Gallery Club, had installed a photography exhibition called The Passing of Time that featured two Bakehouse artists, Amanda Bradley and Maritza Kaneka. And we had gotten really good feedback from our visitors who really liked that the space was activated beyond the galleries and the studios. So we decided to continue using this space to showcase the work of Bakehouse photographers. I know most of our artists, and I began thinking about whose work would fit well together. And I did some research and thought back on some conversations I had had and artworks I had kind of peeked in and seen in studios, and things slowly started falling into place. And for me, the most challenging but also interesting part of the exhibition was the installation of the artworks, since the building has a very particular layout and it's a bit like a maze. So when you approach this, you can approach the same space, like this atrium space here, from different entry points. So you can come in through the main entrance, or come in where I'm standing here, or even through this doorway here. So it was important for me to figure out a way to install the works in a way that was interesting, but also cohesive. I really like this image here, just because it kind of shows what I'm talking about in the sense of trying to kind of make the space cohesive and interesting. You see one of Mateo's works here, and you kind of, as your eyes follow the space, you see another one of his works here. So it's tying these two kind of places that are not so close to each other in a really nice way. So I just thought that this image was a good one to kind of give you an idea. The work of the four artists that are featured in the exhibition are very different in subject and style and aesthetic, but I can see the similarities in the way that they construct images and the way they understand and explore the physicality of place as defined by personal stories and narratives. And I wanted to extrapolate or extend this idea of constructing through narratives to the installation itself. So in this way, the notion of narrative is twofold. It's that a single photograph can possess a narrative quality by presenting or suggesting or calling us to imagine a situation or scene that extends beyond its physical or temporal frame, and simultaneously organizing the photographs in a way that as a whole functions as a narrative. So this kind of twofold idea of an individual image being able to somehow convey a narrative, but also this single image amongst all these other images functioning in a greater narrative and allowing the viewer to make these connections and associations from the individual parts to the whole. So and I forgot to mention earlier on, shout out to Pedro Wasan for being so kind and taking these pictures for me. And also a little bit of a shout out to my sister for helping me manage Photoshop and give our viewers an idea of the artworks in the show. So this grouping of images is in the atrium, and the works, as are the other works in the show, aren't really presented as groupings per artist, but as individual works in communication with each other. And for me, it was about allowing for the creation of a narrative within the space, as I mentioned, but also the duality I guess the duality of the definition or notion of space as well, which is not only a physical presence, but also an emptiness, you know, to be filled. So what is interesting to me was the coexistence of both the play between space occupied and also space that isn't occupied and what can come from that coexistence. And essentially what I was trying to make or show was these spaces in between, which refers to the title of the exhibition, the jumps, the shifts, the changes in time and angle and space and scene as significant as what's in the images themselves. And I think that it's these spaces in between, as I said, that are really fertile and allow for an imagining that adds to the works themselves. And this grouping of images in particular really kind of exude a sense of remoteness to me. You know, from Diana's two images on the left-hand side, which she took in Alaska, which is kind of this desolate landscape almost that we, you know, many of us haven't ever been confronted with or seen, to this smaller image by Rose Marie that has, you know, an interaction between two people that we're, as viewers, not really a part of. So this idea of remoteness, both in landscape, but also in a scene that we aren't really privy to, this kind of almost a secret that we wish we knew, but we don't. So just to give everyone a little bit of an idea of the space further, this is an image of Diana's works. I'm gonna just throw you guys back here a second. So if you would make a right over here, is what you would be seeing if you kind of face the atrium wall. And these two images just, I felt, functioned really beautifully there. And it's almost like you're looking through a window, and the size of the works allows for a little bit of a distance, right? So you're walking away, but you can still see them relatively clearly. In contrast, if you were standing here and you were to make a 180, you'd happen upon Rose Marie's Naturaleza Muerta series, which she and I discussed. And she printed in postcard size because she felt it spoke a little bit more to her project. And I, and Rose will talk further about this, but she works a lot with books. And we, it's interesting that, you know, on one hand you have this, these two larger images that you can see from pretty far away distance, but then for Rose, you really need to be closer to the images and interact with them in a more intimate way. So it's a little bit of an opposition that I really liked. Between these two, it's a little bit difficult to explain this exhibition through photographs because it's really about moving within a particular space. But between one end of the hallway and this end of the hallway where Rose's pictures are, there is a series of images that I just really love because just kind of by chance, they worked out really, really beautifully visually. To the left-hand side is another of Rose's images paired with Mateo's. They're actually studio doors between them and the same for Diana and Clara's works. But, you know, when I was installing the show, it was just one of those things that happened naturally where the red of Rose's shirt just kind of was as visually appealing as the red in Mateo's image. And then the kind of flare up of the skirt of the dancer kind of paralleled the ice in Diana's image. And it, like, these just, these four images, it was one of those things that I hadn't really seen before. And then while we were installing, it was just like, oh, wow, they really kind of communicate and function very beautifully with each other. So just giving you a little bit more of an idea of the space. We reached the end of the hallway. We would be making a left, and this is another of Rose's images here from her series, El Libro Supremo de la Suerte. And it's, this is a little bit difficult for me to explain, but were you to turn right here, you would then have Mateo's work to your back, I suppose, and then to the right-hand side is that image that I just pointed out of Rose's. So essentially, you would be reaching the end of the exhibition, or actually, this could very well be the beginning because the Bakehouse has a back door, which if you approach the exhibition, you'd be approaching it from this end, which would be your beginning. And I'll end with that just because I felt that to be a very poetic idea of how stories and narratives kind of, the beginning and the end is not as, they can essentially function as each other, right? So I thought that this was a very beautiful way to interact with an exhibition where you can start from here and end where we started off, or vice versa. And the narratives and the stories present in the images, but also in the spaces between those images, will speak to everyone in a very particular and different way. So I won't take up too much more of your time with my exhibition and my kind of curatorial idea. But I will let the artists speak for themselves. So maybe we'll do it by alphabetical order. So Rose, do you wanna go ahead? Let me unmute you.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay, cool.
Thank you for that lovely introduction.
Yeah, of course.
I'm excited, you know, to hear even more about how you really wanted to activate space in the gallery with the work. And that's something that I'm interested in my work when I've exhibited in the past is, you know, how can we show photographs not only just in the line on the wall, but in a way to engage a viewer through a space as if they were sculptures or paintings. And that's something that I tried to do, was thinking about space and engaging viewers in a more, in a way that created more active viewership in my book, that, which there are a few images from this book that was published in late 2018 in the exhibition. And it was all just a quick introduction of this book is that it was the title is appropriated from this small number booklet called La Chorada, and it's a Cuban Chinese number system where every number has a different meaning. Like you can kind of see here, 48 is cucaracha, 52 is bicycle, and this book is a collection of images made in Havana, Cuba over about an 8-year period. And there's a loose narrative about this number system, and based on my friend Milagro's love of playing the underground illegal lottery. And basically, you know, I wanted to make a more personal narrative of the specific geography, Havana, which is, you know, not, from Seattle. I went there the first time in 2005 and kept going back. And I wanted, you know, creating almost like an ode to a place that really informed who I am today as a person and an artist. I concentrated on this way of seeing the world that I learned there through my friend and just being in the space, and really looking at the everyday and the mundane and making things more monumental through the act of photographing them. And it was a similar action to how, just kind of randomly going through this book, how what my friend was looking at her life and finding things like, you know, if a bicycle, if her neighbor bought a new bicycle, then she might play 52 in the lottery because it aligned with the numbers. And then in the book, there are different size pages to also to have, there's no linear narrative here in this book. And I wanted to also create different ways that images could react to each other, kind of like in the exhibition where if you look from one way, you see these two in a relationship between two images. And if you look from another way, you see a different relationship. And so that's kind of the reasoning for the structure of the book. And then the other project with the postcards, I'll show you guys a couple images real quick about from that series. Let me just share my screen. All right, can you see that image of a chair and oranges? Okay. This was a project of images made in a much shorter time period, and maybe a week spent in the Choco region in Colombia, which is on the Pacific side, where you either take a small plane or a boat. There's no roads that lead to Choco, and for many years it's been kind of off limits for a lot of visitors due to a region that was unstable with paramilitary groups and drug trade over there. And now the region is a lot safer for people to come and go. And even Choco Tourism Board is really inviting people to come and experience all the amazing things Choco has to offer. One of those being a lot of endemic species. And I was kind of interested in this idea of a quote remote place kind of becoming more engaged with a certain aspect of globalization in terms of tourism. And so I decided to make still lives of different fruit and plants, some of them endemic to Choco, mixed with different plastic items. And, you know, my idea with the postcards was almost a reference to a certain colonial history, and also a history of, and also kind of a reference to this invitation of tourism, and, you know, an interest in how Choco was going to maintain their amazing, their local sustainability while engaging in this, in globalization through tourism. So that is, that's my work that's in the exhibition. So thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you. And thank you for showing us the book. I think that images art can be read differently, and within a space they function in a certain way versus, you know, being in a book, right? So it's, you're interacting with them in a different way. So it's nice to know that they're in, you know, you meant them to be also in a book form, and for it kind of to be a more intimate experience, kind of reflecting the one you have in Cuba since you've been going for so long, and you've kind of made or created these more intimate relationships with the people, but also being able to see them in an exhibition space is beautiful. So thank you for showing your...
This is an exhibition of the work from the book. So, you know, I think that it kind of shows that, and we hadn't really talked about this before, but, you know, just getting people to move within a space by, you know, whether photographs are larger or smaller, mm-hmm. in a book too, whether they're, you know, overlapping or not, was something that I'm interested in. And I think that you really pulled out nicely in this exhibition.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Rose. Diana, do you want to take it from here? Let me unmute you. Hold on.
Can you hear me now?
We can hear you now.
Well, hi, Ru. We knew before we start. I didn't know your work, Rose, before. And wow, it's very humbling to share the space with you. Absolutely, yeah. Amazing. And I really love that book that you did about Cuba. Kind of connect a little bit with you, and then I know I didn't thought about it after I started doing more research about you, but I did some work lately about my hometown from my grandparents in Spain, and I've been going since I was a kid. And since I have a camera, I've been photographing it. And I just told Laura in the interview last week, like, I've been accumulating all this work from this town that I don't know how to digest. And you just showed me this beautiful book. So thank you.
Yeah, it sounds like you have an amazing archive that you might want to look at sometime.
Yeah, and I was like forced to go for a personal reason. My grandpa has an accident right before coronavirus crisis. So yeah, I did this very personal work, and I love what you just show, because I feel very motivated to keep working on that project, basically. I think it will keep going, because he's doing awesome. So more excuses to go back, basically, if time's allowed. So I'm Diana, hello. And my background is from a business background. So my photographic has always been like a hobby in my life. So it was a personal research. I didn't study formally after like 8 years being like an empiric learner. So basically my work was influenced by, I will say first, my family. I have photographers in the family since my grandparents. Like the brother of my grandfather was a photographer in the 18th century back in Spain. And then there was always a manual and cameras around me. So I think that's been around. There was always good photos to see from my family. So I think my work is very influenced from a personal point of view, everything that I've been doing, and my beginning point was documenting life, family life, traveling, and that kind of become more professional at the point that I was becoming more professional in my professional life. Like I was doing a master's degree, and that's when I decided I want to be a better photographer, and I took a manual camera. And I started doing in parallel both things. Time passed by and I decided that I want to be a photographer and I don't want to do more finance in my life. So it's a very, very interesting evolution in my life. I've been doing it since 2007. So it will be 13 years now that I've been photographing with no major formally starting, and I've been a part of the Bakehouse for the last 2 years. And Laura invited me to be part of the exhibition, and I'm very humbled to be there. Thank you. And I'm maybe being a landscaping photographer for the past few years, even though all the personal work, this landscape's been involved in what I've been doing personally. She showed a couple of photos there that she said were from Alaska. They're not from Alaska. Sorry. One is sorry.
I apologize.
Ujuni, Bolivia. So it's okay. The South Flats. On the left and on the right side, you pick an image from a national park that's in Oregon that is called, and then I'm not gonna remember the name. It's not a very popular park, and it's a volcano in the middle of a lake, and I can't remember the name right now, sorry. but you pick those couple of images to pair that were not paired in my imagination. At the beginning, I have the South Flat combined with another image from the South Flat, from Bolivia, and you totally pick two different moments in my life and put them together. And it feels nice because I kind of give them in time in them, and then you just break them and put them together in space. And also happened with two images of Alaska that I took in different time space, and you combine them in the exhibition.
So I created my own narrative for
just from the beginning. And then now I see how you create a narrative with the other pieces, especially when in the alley that is hard to see because of the doors. But now that I see it in your plants, how they match with the red and the lines and the space, and they communicate, and I love it. That was a different way. And they also have a different texture because you cannot see it in the photos, but there are. One is mounting glass, one is bare on wood, the other one is just the paper hanging on two pieces of bamboo, and the other pieces mount, frame it. So, but there are bare, there's glass, one glass, I think, right? No, there's no glass, right, at all in the whole.
No, the five
so the
images.
Whole thing is organic.
Yeah, the five images I have of yours are.
And the whole group, I think, is all bare.
Yeah, so yours, what fits in really beautifully is that you have an image that is of the sand, you know, where the water has receded, and it has these like curvatures, and it's actually right next to a work by Mateo, where you see like have kind of like a close-up of like a neck, and the curves of the neck kind of like are really beautifully, like there's just this symmetry. So yeah, all your works in the show are printed and then kind of like very lightly framed, I guess you would say, with two bamboo, yeah, things at the end. So
they're not hiding in reflections, and that's very organic. I love that also of how the installation was thought.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Diana. And I'm sorry that I misplaced your geographically.
In a random place. Where's sign the
but yeah, thank you. And I mean, for me, like seeing those images in your studio was just kind of like it clicked, you know. I know they're not from the same place, but they just look so beautiful together. So I won't keep you waiting. Mateo, do you want to go ahead and talk a little bit about your works in the show?
Yeah, of course. Well, first of all, hi to everyone that joined us tonight. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, ladies, for, you know, just being here, and Laura for putting this show together. I think you did a wonderful job making it so cohesive. When the work at first impression, it's so varied. So yeah, I think the show in its totality is very cohesive, apart from it being so varied. I deal mainly with the exploration of the human body. Sometimes it comes across as landscape, although that's not my main intent. My main intent is to just focus on the little details of the body and sort of make the viewer forget that you're looking at a body, but at the same time make the viewer question their own body. So it's kind of like it's a mixture between, it's a play between being present within yourself, but also getting lost in the landscape of the body. And I think scale has a lot of, it's a huge factor. And when I say scale, I mean how the work is presented. So, you know, you see some of my work in the exhibition, I have one very small piece and then the others are, they're pretty large. So that plays a huge factor in how the work comes across to the viewer. And I find that there is intimacy in both scales. The small scales, like Rose's works, those tiny prints, they're really inviting, and you have to get like really up close to the work to, you know, to fully experience it and sort of travel into the space that is captured. And when the much larger pieces, you can see them from afar, but the scale is so large that they also invite you to come up close to it and investigate the little details. So there is intimacy in both spaces. And I think that correlates really well with the work that's being depicted. You know, some of Rose's work and Diana's work, there's landscapes. But they're captured in such a manner that for an instance, you can't tell if you're really close or if it's like an aerial view of something. So I think that perspective is the way that, and I think the title of the show, this you know, space in between, it just plays into that whole notion of what's my distance between what I'm looking at and where I find myself in reality. It's a beautiful moment that I think that, I speak for myself, but I think a lot of photographers can agree that why we photograph is to capture moments that we would otherwise just dismiss. And living in that space between, you know, being like really close and really far away and just, you know, freezing that moment and being able to relive it. It kind of like gets rid of time. So, and you know, I like to incorporate the human body because it's something that we can all relate to.
And then you started, I didn't mention this, but you started this series a while ago. So what has kind of kept you going back? Because I know you've taken on other projects. But what kind of keeps you going back to this series of, like, you know, the human body? And I know a lot of them are dancers that you are friends with or personally know. So what kind of keeps you going back to this subject matter specifically, or this series specifically?
It's the energy that I share with whom I'm photographing. So, you know, it happens when you're photographing inanimate objects and landscapes, but I think it happens a lot more when you're photographing people, that there's an evident conversation happening. There's an evident exchange of information happening. And I think what attracts me the most is the trust that I build with my subjects. And I like to think of my work as not my work, but a collaboration between myself, the photographer, and the subject. It's because I feed off of their energy, and them being dancers, they're very expressive people. So I feed off of that energy. And when I begin a photo shoot, I only go into the photo shoot with certain parameters, but I don't intend on capturing like the perfect shot. You know, I just I give the dancers a few parameters and I allow them to improvise movement in accordance to you know, a certain vision that I have, but I let them the energy just speak for itself. I let the dancer just reveal how they feel. And one of the key elements that I like to throw into a mixture is color, because color has a huge influence on how we perceive things. So I may just bring the dancer and just incorporate a single color or two colors in the composition and allow the dancers to just respond with their bodies, which is, you know, how they express themselves. So that's what mainly attracts me to going back to this series.
I actually think that this is an interesting segue, because like you said, you feed off, like for you, you feed off this energy from people, and you feel it much more with people than with anything else. But Clara, who a lot of her photography is actually inanimate things, like I feel like she would say that something similar, but about like the things she photographs that, you know, that aren't people. So I think this is like an interesting comparison for you to be like one after another. So Mateo, thank you for that. And Clara, do you want to go ahead and talk a little bit about your series and in the exhibition?
Sure, let me
Wait, you muted.
Hold on.
I think you're
okay. There you go.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
Well, hello, and thank you for having me here. Something amazing just happened today that I didn't know about, and it has a lot to do with my photographs. I just noticed that Rose's pictures were taken in a very special place for me in Colombia called Chocó. I am from there, but I'm from Colombia. More importantly, I was mostly raised by a woman from there. And when I was growing up, she used to help me go to bed, telling me bedtime stories about imaginary places. And she will create those stories as I will go to sleep every night. And she's my second mother. I love her to death. She's in Colombia. But when I go out with my camera and I take photographs, I think a lot about her. And I'm really touched by this because she's a very important person that I remember when I go out, because I'm usually photographing things that I photograph mostly objects that are discarded, that nobody's interested in anymore, that people find that are not important for whatever reason. And I find a lot of peace in photographing those things. And part of the reason why I like to do this, I believe, is because it kind of reminds me of a time when I will be entertained by stories that were made up at the moment. So when I go out with a camera that requires that I take time and that I think about what I'm doing and that I need to move at a slower pace. So I just walk around wherever I am. It can be in my backyard or it can be in another part of the world. But I'm always looking for those stories that I can make up with things that some people will call garbage, but that I find my little treasures or objects that I find beautiful but that nobody will pay attention to. And that's kind of the narrative that I have when I photograph. I find a lot of peace in that chaos. And part of the photos, I mean, most of the photos that I take are probably trying to find some order in that chaos that I find, but that I also find really beautiful. When I'm in the process of photographing, I just stop, I look at the objects, I photograph them, I try to make a nice composition out of them. Sometimes, many times I make up stories in my mind about what happened to those objects. And that's pretty much how I photograph. The pictures for this exhibit were taken on Route 66 on a road trip that I did with the school I belong to. And it was a beautiful trip. We were 20 students and I just chose to take a different path, and I would just go find again the things that probably nobody will photograph just because they might not be considered beautiful. So most of the pictures that I have are photographs of, I have some that, let me change my background so you can see one of them, but I mean, I found like the Fisher Prize house that that nobody paid attention to in the garbage. I found toys. I found all these things that I found a lot of poetry in them. And that's pretty much what the project is all about finding beauty and order and sense on things that nobody considers important.
And it's a series that you've continued through the present, and you've actually been posting about of the neighborhood, you know, near Bakehouse, Alapata, and it's, you know, like you said, it's, there's this like beauty in you know, in these things that are now discarded. And I mean, I urge everyone attending to not only check out Clara's Instagram, but all our photographers. So yeah, this is one of them. Clara, can you tell us a little bit about?
Yeah, let me move so you can see it. But this, this is a photo that I took a few blocks away from the Bakehouse. And I really love that photograph because I think that piece of furniture, they almost look like ghosts, or like, I think they're very graceful. They're very elegant. They're abandoned there. They're rusty. But again, I just loved it. And I think that in our neighborhood, there are so many beautiful front yards and backyards that are filled with those treasures that I just enjoy very, very much going around on this quest, looking for those things that I feel create beautiful spaces or sculptures or stories or poems. So that one was taken a couple of blocks away from the Bakehouse. Yeah.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Clara. it wasn't too bad.
It was.
So if anyone has any questions for our artists, please feel free to ask them through the chat box. I have a couple questions myself. We have a bit of time left. And something I wanted to ask the four of you is that I feel like photography is a process of selection in both the act of determining what you photograph, but also, you know, in the process that follows, editing, framing, etc. So as artists, how do you, in your mind, how do you construct images? How do you decide what you're going to photograph? Is it a very kind of in the moment? I know that you'll have different answers. Or do you, for example, think about what you're going to go to, what you're going to photograph, and then, so what's your process in this idea of constructing images?
Do you ladies mind if I start?
No.
So I think it's a mixture of everything. Laura, in the beginning you said something, what was it you said? Let me circle back to that. But Rose, you also said something about making the mundane monumental. And it is, it's about finding those spaces or those little moments that you would otherwise just dismiss. To me, photography is about slowing down and observing what's in front of us. And you know, Laura, you asked what is it? Do we go out and search for something specifically, it really depends, because sometimes, you know, I'll photograph dancers in the studio and I'm looking for something in particular, but other times I'll go on a photo walk and I'll just let the environment influence me, and I'm just walking with my camera and I'm, you know, I'm looking for something that catches my eye, something that makes me stop walking, and you know, like it's looking for beautiful moments, right? So personally, I look for geometry. I think everything is composed of geometry, and I look for intersecting lines or complementary colors. That's what I look for. So it's just a mixture of a lot of factors there.
Oops, I'm muted. Ladies, do you have anything to add to that?
Sure. I think that, you know, I think that I work in, you know, two different ways. One is a really intuitive way, when I'm trying to figure out, I mean, all my work is based around, is in the past been based around different specific geographies where I'm trying to maybe tell a different narrative about a place. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in Havana, I started just photographing intuitively at first and then looking through images kind of to, my looking back at images I had taken was able to define my vision and what I wanted to express more clearly, and then was able to, you know, go back and with a more defined vision, you know, start like finishing the project. But, you know, in Choco, when I went for the first time with a Colombian friend who was going there to hope maybe open up a business. And she was my guide. And I went with this kind of idea already preconceived. So the concept came first because I had done some research. I mean, the postcard idea didn't come till later, but for me, it really depends on whether it's even a more personal project or a more conceptual project, and it varies per project the approach. But,
Great, thank you, Rose. Clara, do you want to, or Diana, do you want to add to it?
Yeah, I can. depends on the project. So landscape, you want to plan as much as you can. So for landscaping, well, no secret that you want to run for the sunrises, the sunsets, and the magic hours, and the blue lights. So you have a schedule, you have a plan, you come, and there's a storm, and there's wind, and it's not going to happen. So yeah, there's a lot of planning involved, but then you get what you get out of that. So yeah, landscape is a lot of, you try to plan, but then something else could happen, and it's wonderful because my subject is the planet, so he can do whatever he wants with me, basically. And sometimes you don't have time to stay longer or plan longer. Or, for example, the time I decide I want to do the Milky Way, well, you have to wait until 2 a.m. so the moon is gone. You can see the Milky Way straight on your head. So yeah, that subject needs a lot of planning. But then I like to do all this documental work that is just spontaneous. And I'm just, for that, I'm carrying my camera with probably a 50 or just a 35, nothing else. And then shooting all day long in my house, my family, or some of the work that I done in Miami with I don't know.
And
communities, stuff that I like to do. And there I wanna be like very quiet and small camera and they don't see me, and it's like a different approach to work on that, right? And the type of things that we do with the school with Clara.
Diana, do you feel like your landscape work, which is the one, and I know that you, like you said, you have different projects and kind of ways of working, but do you feel like the landscape, your landscape work or images, like the images that are in the show, do you try at all to address a notion of human presence and like human intervention in the environment, or are you just like,
I tend to not have humans in my images.
Right.
And when I put them in the image, I want them to be like, give me a perspective of a space of how we tiny are in terms of this subject that is planet for me, let's say. Because yeah, this subject is Earth in all his possible presentations. It could be, as Mateo say, a landscape that looks like might be like I did a macro is taken from a plane, but then the one that is made like a macro, you think it was taken from the plane. You have that those two in the exhibition, you pick them. And that's just Earth showing their textures. And yeah, I tend to put the human away, but then somehow show it. So in one of the images you pick, the white one, I think I can share here. I have footprints, so that's the human presence, but very tiny. And you can only probably see it on the paper, very big print on the wall. Not so much like in the Instagram account. So, yeah.
And
kind of, you try to plan, I guess.
but not everything is planned. I think it depends on the project and the subject. And I love what Rose said, that she's, when she was doing the Cuba project, it's more documentary and she probably find holes in the project that she then went to address on a possible way back to the place or where are you documenting. But I, you can always do that though.
I think it's important to be prepared and to learn about places you are going to visit. I think it's part of being respectful and curious about the places you are going to visit. But I also think it's important to have an open mind to what might come along that you didn't know about or that you were not expecting. And I think that they both can go well together. There are times, I think that there are times when you do the documenting part for which you prepared, but then you also do the surprising part that that also might work really well.
And Clara, speaking a little bit to what you just said, you know, and having the sort of sensitivity to place and to the people within that place, how do you feel like you express specificity in your work? Because really, you know, I knew that your images were taken down Route 66 because you told me, or that the image behind you was taken, you know, near the Bakehouse because you told me, right? So do you try to somehow express that specificity in your work, or do you want the viewer to look at your image and think this could be anywhere, right?
I'm so glad you're asking me that because I will prefer for the images to be from anywhere. And that because I guess I have had the opportunity to travel. And the more, I mean, the older I get and the more I travel, I realize that the stories, the realities, the experiences, the sadness, the joys are very similar in the end. So, I mean, a dining table is a dining table anywhere, or a toy, or a place to gather, or a place for prayer. It ends up being very similar everywhere. So there are countries that are more specific, and maybe the images will reveal where I'm at. But I'm really not that interested in that. I'm more interested in documenting the daily life or something that might have happened, but I guess more related to the emotions as opposed to the geographic of the place, the geography of the place.
And Rose, how would you respond to that same question? Because I feel like you might be coming at it from a slightly different point of view. So the both of you are creating very beautiful images, but with set in a kind of like local or geographical context, but I think maybe coming at it from different kind of ideas in mind, since you have photographed quite a few places in Cuba and Colombia and Panama. And I'm just gonna tack on a question that I got from one of our attendees, Roberto Mata. Shout out to Roberto, Bakehouse artist, who says that he would also like to hear a little bit more about the book and the idea that the pages aren't all the same sizes, and what was that, what was the intention behind that?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, for me, place or geography is really important. You know, this is definitely a book. I mean, it's not a declaration that this book represents in any way, like how Cuba is or what it is. It just happens to represent my personal experience there and what I learned in that space, which, you know, I couldn't have learned anywhere else. So even though, you know, it doesn't say Havana, Cuba until the end of the book, you know, where I kind of like the book has like my own personal handwriting, which is not that great. I'm left-handed, and you know, but I wanted it to have like the kind of a journalistic feel, and it just narrates throughout the book the number system in a very simple way. But yeah, places, it's, you know, this couldn't have been done any. There are traces of political, there are, you know, in the background, there are things that define different spaces that, you know, that you can't avoid, you can't get out of, you know, the fact that I was, you know, coming to Cuba as, you know, from the United States, you know, a lot of my friends at the time, like, weren't leaving Cuba. So there's also this idea of, you know, authorship and subjectivity and, you know, political histories and power, which is, I think, always something I'm interested in within subject and photographer. But also like very real relationships too. And then, you know, I'm also making work in Miami, which I don't think could be made anywhere else. So although an image can like step outside of itself and be relatable to somebody who's never been to Cuba, who's, you know, never been to Miami, you know, I really am interested in like what makes a place a place. And as for the small pages, I was struggling, you know, to figure out how to make, trying to find a good example here, to make all these images, all these years of work into a book, because I wanted a narrative arc, you know, like I was inspired by literature, by, you know, a point of tension and kind of two thirds of the way through. But there weren't like these concrete characters. You know, I felt a lot of people I was working with were kind of models or photographing myself as like looking more at gesture than an actual story. So a designer I worked with, Ben Salice, designer from Paris, but who I met in New York, he, you know, came into my studio and was like, do you want some help with this? And I was like, yeah, I do. And it was his idea to make these kind of small pages where if you turn a page, you know, there's a new scene created. A lot of them kind of are maybe more private moments with more public moments too. Or sometimes the book is edited by color as well, like the exhibition, you know, it's like Andrea was talking about how color has a lot of meaning and, you know, can really translate a lot of significance, which I think a lot of times is ignored a lot, you know, in day to day, especially in some place like, you know, New York, where everybody wears black, or, you know, but that's kind of, that was the, this avoiding this linear structure that I feel like is so forced on photography, books or on the wall, was something I wanted to try and do.
Yeah, thank you, Rose and Clara as well. I think it's, I mean, at least for me, coming from a curatorial perspective, it was interesting because it's almost like some of you are coming from opposite points of view, but convert, like your visual language somehow converges like really beautifully. So I was lucky that I got to work with all of you and that all your work just really spoke nicely to each other in that way. And we've hit the 7:01 mark, but I have one more question to end the discussion with that was asked by an attendee, and it says, this is Brenda Freeman, who's one of the Bakehouse board members, so I appreciate her being here. She's asking, has the pandemic influenced your work in any interesting way? And if so, how? And I'm going to tack on my own question. I keep giving you guys double questions, but in difficult and uncertain times like the one we are currently living in, to what extent do you think photography should focus on documenting, recording, and bearing witness? So I don't know if anybody wants to take one or both of those questions. I know, Rose, I don't know if you want to start. You're doing a little bit of work around the coronavirus situation. I don't know if you want to speak to that, those questions.
Sure. I mean, definitely, I think it's, we all know, like when we look at the news or, you know, I don't know if you guys saw the front page of the New York Times on, I think it was Saturday or Sunday, where all the names or 1,000 people who have passed away due to coronavirus were listed on the front page. I mean, that's a graphic image, but just knowing that's 1/1,000th of all the people who have passed away of coronavirus is, I think, a great example of how design and art, even in a newspaper, can really impact and send a message, you know? Obviously, you know, I'm a artist photographer, but also I make my living a lot from journalism too. I work as a journalist and an editorial photographer. And, you know, I have been covering some of the coronavirus here in Miami And you know, I think that if I didn't have a baby, I probably would be pitching bigger stories and, you know, going out there more and being a little bit more, brave about it. But I definitely think there should be more images of coronavirus in the United States. I'm not seeing enough in media, to be honest. I know I saw a lot more coverage of the Ebola crisis in Africa. And I mean, maybe that's because people are, it's okay seeing people suffer in other countries and not here. But I think that we need to see more, because I feel personally like people aren't really getting the impact of this. But I also think that art serves a purpose in these kinds of things that maybe reveals itself with more time. You know, maybe we'll look back when things are slower, like a sculpture or a video or a poem, you know, acts of witness to this time that maybe aren't made now, but later on we'll tell other people what we went through at this time, which, you know, so different ways that images function in journalism or in art. And that's my personal take. But.
Would anybody like to add to that? Anybody creating work that is in response to the situation, or any take on what you feel the role of photography or art in general should be during something like what we're going through?
I've been doing it a little bit, but in a less joyful way, let's say. I guess it's kind of a sad process, because as I drive around and do the same photographs of backyards and front yards, it's kind of a nostalgic job as opposed to a joyful one. But I have been doing it, and I'm very glad I'm doing it, because I think that I will have some pretty interesting memories of a time when the inflatable pool was what entertained the children, and I'm not doing, I mean, and I have been photographing a little bit of downtown and things like that, but I'm glad I'm doing it. I'm trying to continue the same. Yeah.
Mateo, did you want to say something as well?
I think art in general serves a purpose of expression. I mean, you know, this is something that's affecting not just a small community, but the whole world. And, you know, I think not just artists should be creating work in response to this, but I think everyone needs to do something in response to it. Art in its entirety is subjective. So, you know, whatever it is that people feel that they need to express, just go ahead and do it, you know, because, you know, something Clara just said, like, you want to, you know, when all this quiets down, you want to look back and see how your life was impacted. Whatever you feel that you need to say, or, you know, if you're inclined to paint or to photograph, so be it. Personally, I've photographed mainly people, but, you know, because I've been in quarantine, I switched over to landscape. I've been photographing a lot of landscape, and I've been, I'm grateful that, thankfully I have a river in my backyard. So I've just been going out on my kayak on the river and photographing the nature around me, and that has kept my sanity a little bit. So that's a way that my work has transitioned.
Thank you. Diana, do you want to add anything to?
It's a lot of meditation, right, Mateo?
What's that?
Landscape.
Yeah, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing to get lost in your environment.
It is. I have plans to go to this park, and I lost the tickets and everything because coronavirus, so yeah, it changed the plans a little bit. I've been doing film these days, and totally random, not related, and I don't know how sometime I'm gonna find the answer, but it's been like, I mean, like using other people's cameras. So that's been my thing during the coronavirus. I use my grandpa's camera, then I use one of my best friend's cameras, and now I'm taking Pedro's camera. And why? I don't know. It's been a very personal journey. A lot of it's empty spaces and kind of landscapes in the city, and we'll see what it comes. But yeah, it drastically changed our life, because we were doing wedding photographer and social events, and everything totally stopped for us from the point of view of work. We also have a printer in the studio that is kidnapped by the Bakehouse. No, I'm kidding. It's okay. It's too big to take it out. So we also stopped printing. That is the second thing that I love the most, is taking photos out of the machine, out of the computer, and make it real and touchable. So yeah, from the personal point of view, I think everybody has been affected here and there. I love what Rose says. I think I'd agree. There's not much coverage from the photojournalist point of view, what's going on in the US. You see really harsh images from Europe. Not here, it's true. A little bit from New York, but not much of what's going on. And yeah, maybe we end with a lot of that.
Well, I thank the four of you very much for taking the time to join in this webinar with me, and for letting me bother you for 2 weeks straight about this. But it's been a really kind of rewarding experience for me to work with the four of you and to kind of find the beauty in your work individually, but also as a group. And I hope that you feel the same. And I hope that the people that are attending can somehow get a feel for the exhibition, but also for your work when we reopen due to the coronavirus. But I thank all of you, and I hope to see the four of you very soon at Bakehouse. So thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
So yeah, I can hear the rain from, I don't know if it's raining by any of you. It's pretty hard over here in
it's terrible.
Downpouring
everywhere.
I think it's time for all of us to have a glass of wine and watch a movie.
Thank you so much.
I'm gonna go for hot cocoa.
Okay. I don't want to.
Thank you so much, Laura. You really are amazing. I'm very grateful for everything you do, but for this one in particular. Thank you for including me.
Thank you, Clara. Thank you, Diana. Thank you, Mateo. Thank you, Rose. A big hug to all of you, and we'll talk soon.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.